Oh, I'm muted.
You should be muted.
I am muted. I never checked.
And we're live. A little behind the scenes conversation. Hey there, Lindsay here, the frugal crafter, feeling out of sorts here with Sarah this morning.
Hello.
We are going to do a watercolor painting today, and there is a link to the reference photo in the video description if you want to go check that out. We're going to be using watercolors. I'm going to be sketching with watercolor pencils. You can use a regular pencil if you want. Just let us know in the comments if you can hear and see everything clearly. It looks good on our end. And this video is sponsored by jerrysartorama.com. I'm actually using the Lucas paints today. I thought I was going to use my core, but then this little palette fits better in screen and has all the colors I need. So this is the kit that I am using. So if you go to Jerry's, just search Lucas watercolors and you can find the kit or tubes or whatever you want if you want these particular paints. But as always, use what you have. I'm going to sketch on with a Caran d'Ache watercolor crayon. The brand really isn't important. You can use whatever you want. I'm going to kind of start by putting in this spiky line. I don't know if it's showing up very well on screen, so I'm going to kind of tip it a little bit so you can see just a little line there. And then I'm going to sketch on some buds, some ovals. I might have to switch to a regular pencil. I'm thinking that might be a little too light. Hold it up there. I think, oh, there you go. There. The light adjusted so we can see a little bit better now.
We're back in the basement, so we're adjusting from being upstairs to being downstairs.
Yeah, so you'll probably hear some foot like noises and stuff as kids roam around. Everybody hear and see us okay?
Yeah, I think so.
Oh, good, good. And I'm just going to continue that stem down here. And now I'm going to add some petals. So with a snapdragon, you've got kind of like a spike of flowers, and then you have like different, like as each one of these little buds is like a bloom, and generally you have some flowers that like have, that have popped or snapped open down at the bottom, and you'll still have some unopened buds at the top, so they kind of bloom for a while. So the way that the petals go, they kind of have a couple like bumps, and then they're going to kind of come down almost like a bell, and then they have nice ruffly petals, and then you'll see them kind of come around like that. So that would be like the way one petal looks. Now there's another petal on top. The clickety clackety of Sarah's dog Chewy. And this is almost like how one of the top iris petals look, and we're just going to make a shape like that. And then the one next door is exactly the same, just coming in from the other direction. Whoops, I just broke my... I'd used my comb sharpener so I could get a really long point, but I pressed too hard and it broke. So not a big deal, but that's why that happened. Okay, now I'm going to do another one of these flowers, but you're seeing it from the side. It almost looks kind of like a sweet pea, a sweet pea petal. And we're going to do the side petal lobe here. And then we're going to see just a little bit of the other one. So it'd be like I was sketching this one, but it's from the side. And then we're going to see this one kind of coming off, just kind of tucking out from behind it. So what we just did with those two petals, but we did it on the flower next door. And then we've got this one looping up higher. And what we're actually drawing would be like this petal, but it's on a sideways facing flower. So we're seeing foreshortening, and we're not going to see all of this petal. This one's just going to kind of tuck up and wrap around. And then we're going to do another one over here, and it might go off the paper, and that's fine. And we're going to just kind of get, so basically what we're doing is this petal, this is, we're just going to see a little bit of that.
Beverly Mossman,
yep.
Lindsay, is this a harder lead type in the pencils you are using?
Well, it's the Caran d'Ache Supercolor. It's I would say medium. It's about the same as a Derwent for hardness watercolor pencil. Watercolor pencils, I think, tend to be a little bit, they're not as soft as a Prismacolor, but they are pretty soft and fragile. So you shouldn't press too hard with them. So this petal here would correspond to like that one. And then we've got this other one. We're just seeing like a little bit of it kind of peeking up beyond. And I think I'm going to make this bud a little bit bigger. Like it's just getting ready to pop because it's the next one up on the stem, and I'm going to tuck in another couple ones just to kind of flush it out a little bit. All right, now we're going to wet the background. And some people had asked me about the Zen brush I picked up when I was in Massachusetts. So I thought I would try that one out today. I have used it a couple times and I like it. It is another synthetic. It's a synthetic that's supposed to act like a natural hair brush. So very similar to like the Mimics, but this is a filbert, or you know, it kind of comes up to a point like that. So I like brushes like this, and this is a half inch wide. So I can get a nice wide wash, or I can get right up on the tip and I can get in with some detail. It's not as snappy as the Mimic Kalinskis. It's more like the Mimic Squirrels. If you're painting at home and you want to get something a little bit more similar. And this is made by the Royal and Langnickel Brush Company, and you can pretty much find their brushes anywhere, including Jerry's Artorama, our sponsor. So what I want to do is wet this paper, and I want to have an even sheen. And I'm just doing the background. I'm going around my flower.
Tyler McGrew? I was watching one of your older videos, and at the start of the video, you broke your paintbrush, but said you could just glue it back together. Do you still fix them, or do you buy new ones?
Oh, if the bristles are fine, I'd fix them. Sometimes that happens, like the ferrule, the metal part, will come loose from the wooden handle or the plastic handle, especially if it's a plastic handle or resin handle. Just glue that right back together. If it's a wooden one, sometimes I'll use like a pair of pliers and just glue it and then crimp it, so I crimp the metal to the wooden handle. Since I teach classes, it's always good to have extra high quality brushes. So there's no way I would throw away a brush just because the top came loose. And sometimes I actually cut my brushes short if I want them to fit in like a travel kit and I don't have room to fit it in my box otherwise. So no, I rarely. I'm not going to throw away something that still works. I'll have it as an extra in my class.
That's why you're the frugal crafter.
That's right. You know, waste stuff just because you have.
It's a little broken, a little damaged. Yeah.
But that wouldn't even affect the quality of you know, its working properties, really. Okay, so for background, I'm going to start mixing some colors that I'm going to be using in the foreground, too. So I'm going to be using some of this magenta. So I'll just dab a little bit of that in there. And I didn't pre-wet my palette. This is pretty high-quality paint. It reactivates really well, and I haven't used this in a couple weeks, so it's works really well. Now, I like the green here, but it's too bright for what I want, and I don't have a sap green in this set, so I'm actually going to take this and add a little yellow ochre to it to kind of lessen the intensity of it. And I'm going to add that in there. And you can still see it's still pretty bright. I think I need to dull that down a little bit more. Maybe add a little burnt sienna. There we go. Now we're getting a nice earthy green. Now your paint's only going to go where your paper is wet. So since we didn't wet the petals, they should stay nice and white.
Biscuit 115. Hi, Lindsay. How are you?
Not too bad. I got a little bit of a scratchy throat, though, so hopefully.
That's why I'm standing away from her.
She's standing way over there.
Kaber99, are you using color pencil or watercolor pencil?
I used a watercolor pencil. You could use a regular graphite pencil if that's what you have. It doesn't really matter for this project.
Ian Jackson, Lindsay, have you had a look at hashtag World Watercolor Month Facebook site?
I haven't yet, but I do intend to check it out. This month is World Watercolor Month. I don't know who started it, but I like that. I like that idea quite a bit.
Gracie Shack, I have an art class coming up for kids ages 3 to 5 and was wondering what kind of arts crafts I could teach them.
Whatever you feel comfortable and passionate about teaching, because, you know, with kids, I think they're going to want to learn what you're excited about. So if you're not interested or excited about it, then it's going to be really hard to get them to learn. You could do jewelry making. You could do painting. I always find pastels. Kids really like using pastels. We'll do some yellow ochre on its own to brighten things up a little bit. And I can go right over the blossoms there with the yellow ochre right over the buds because it's not going to hurt anything. And then I don't have to worry so much about painting around every little detail.
Laura R, 334 watching live. What's the largest audience you've had?
How many?
334.
Whoa, that's awesome. Holy moly. I think probably the biggest I've ever had was when I did like a nighttime one with some other artists. I think we had over 400 live. That was the biggest one. And, you know, I think I owe a lot of that to my fine guests that I had because their community showed up too. So that was really fun. That was a Ask an Artist live show that we did a few months ago. But yeah, I think that might be the highest we ever had during a daytime.
Yeah, it's at 338 right now.
Wow, thanks guys. That's really great. It's a new router.
That's what it is. Also, summertime, I would imagine, is probably a little, people are on vacation.
Yeah, and maybe some people have like a short week because of the holiday. Maybe they got like a, they're taking their vacation. I wanted some texture in the background. This is going to kind of fade away a bit. So I'm just kind of flicking in some color. I want this to almost look like you're just kind of seeing, you know, stuff in the background, just wildflowers and foliage that are just kind of faded out. So I want to get all that in.
Debbie K's, love your videos, and this is my first live. As Welcome. A beginner and not a great artist, could you do a few videos on basic beginner watercolor? Very, very easy drawings, very simple.
Well, a lot of my watercolors are like that. The hummingbird one's pretty easy. I've got a wildflowers and watercolors, very, very beginner easy project. I would go through and look, especially my oldest watercolor videos, and you'll find more beginner ones. But yeah, I'll keep that in mind and keep doing more beginner ones as time goes on. But if you're itching for some right now, just go back to like 2013, 2012, find my first watercolor ones, and those will be the most beginner ones. Okay, now I'm going to dry this so that I can work on my petals. Before I do that, though, I'm just going to go in any place I have spatters on the petals and just kind of wipe that it doesn't affect anything. And while I'm drying this, if you guys have any questions, go ahead and type them in all caps so Sarah can ask me them.
Shelly Parchman, I have some student pans that I don't like. Any ideas what to do with them?
Excuse me. Oh my gosh. Wow. Yeah, you could put them in spray bottles with water and dissolve them and make spray mists for backgrounds. You could just pop the color out and refill them with better quality paints. You could give them to somebody who's beginning, like a beginning student of watercolor or a child, as long as they're non-toxic. Or you could just kind of practice with them on some, you know, cheap drawing paper, get good at mixing, and then treat yourself to a more professional set.
Gracie Shack, any tips for using oil paints for the first time?
I would recommend water mixable oils if you haven't bought them yet. And I would just say be patient and try not to put too much white in at the beginning, because white can really take over your painting.
Genzi Stuff. Lindsay, have you ever tried the Pentel watercolors?
Yes, I have. It's been a long time. They're more of a student grade. I think I had some in a kit many years ago. They were fine. They're a student grade paint. But then I'm just touching my painting with the back of my hand to make sure it's room temperature and doesn't feel cool, so I'll know it's dry and I can carry on. And I'm going to switch to a different brush. This is another brush I recommend. It's also by the Royal Brush Company. It's the Majestic, and I also like the Aqualon. These are synthetic, but they're not meant to replicate a natural hair brush, so they have a lot more snap. You can see they're very snappy, and they don't hold as much water. So I find that beginners have a little bit better luck with this because they don't end up getting in too much trouble with the water.
Joe Maisky loves the yellow. Looks almost like a quinacridone gold.
Oh, that's the yellow ochre. Well, I think it's a yellow ochre in the Lucas set. I'm going to start with some of this cadmium yellow here at the top lobes of these two flowers. And I'm painting on dry paper because I want to have some control of where everything goes. Then I'm going to try the magenta with that because I don't want to add that orangey red in if I don't have to. So let's see if we get a nice bright mix for that. That's pretty bright. So I think that'll be good for what we're doing. Your dog's making snorty noises.
Yes.
On the floor.
Well, she snuck upstairs to go to the cat box and I busted her. Oh, gross.
Gross.
She's naughty like, oh, they're downstairs. The kids aren't paying attention upstairs. I heard her and I was like, that little beast. That big beast.
Taking an opportunity.
Oh, yeah. Starshine Soldier, what waterproof ink pens do you recommend?
I really like the Microns. They come in a bunch of different sizes and they're really top quality. They don't run when you go over them with, actually they don't run if you go over them with watercolor or with like Copic marker. So that's kind of nice. Now I'm going to wet the remaining area with this Majestic brush, a synthetic, because it won't get me too much water in there. I just want to soften the edge. And then when I add my magenta in, I just want it to kind of, gently fade and blend.
Sophia Tamburo, do you like arts or crafts better?
I probably would say painting is my favorite, but it's nice to do both because if you get bored with one, then you've got the other to work with. And I'm just working this up and blending a little bit in here because I had some hard lines I didn't like. I'm going to rinse and then blend the edge where the orange and pink and yellow meet. So you get a nice soft blend that way.
Marvelous Myrrh, do you recommend Royal Align Nickel watercolors for a beginner?
Yeah, they're a good paint for a beginner because they're not too crazy expensive, but the colors are nice. I really like the pans if you can find them. They're a little bit tougher to find, but yeah, you could definitely use the tubes and squeeze them out to your palette. You might want a little bit of honey in them if you're using the tubes or glycerin so that they don't crack. But yeah, absolutely. But I really, their brushes are really excellent. I think they're more of a brush company that comes out with like different medias so people have something to use with their brushes. Now we're going to do the same thing to this petal here, and then we're going to do it to that petal because those are all the same colors. There's a lot of great paints and brush companies out there. I have to say nowadays, you can really get some good quality stuff pretty affordably. Okay, this time I'm wetting the whole thing and I'm going to go in with my yellow again at the top.
J-Rod, aloha from Hawaii.
Ooh.
New to watercolor and I'm getting a little overwhelmed deciding on quality brushes for a beginner. What brand or brands do you recommend?
Well, I was just talking about this Royal Majestic. For a beginner, I like these because they don't hold too much water, so you're not going to get into trouble because you have too much water in your brush. But after you get a little more experience, I like the Zen by Royal & Lang Nickel. I like the Mimic Kalinske brushes, and I like the Princeton Neptunes. So, but there's so many good brushes out there. Those are just a few of my favorites.
Lorelei Philhour, what is a good watercolor set that's not too expensive?
The Lucas here isn't too bad, and they also have a student grade called Lucas Studio, which is like $12 at Jerry's Artorama. Has all the colors here, except instead of having like a true cadmium, it would be like a hue. It doesn't mean that the paint's gonna fade. The paints are light fast in either set. It just uses less expensive materials in the student set. And it doesn't use like the true cadmiums and true cobalts and that sort of thing.
Grell Sutcliffe, do you have any preference between Copic or Prismacolor?
It really depends on the criteria. Probably like overall, I would prefer the Copic. However, it's a lot more expensive. But I think you can get the same effects with either. You just might work a little harder to blend the Prismacolors. So it just depends on what you absolutely want and what your budget is, because the Prismacolors are a lot cheaper than Copic.
Lorelei Philhour, do you have any tips for opening an Etsy shop?
I don't have an Etsy shop, so my tip would probably be check out Renee Christine on YouTube. Rich Mom Business is her channel, and she does so much stuff with Etsy. She has a thing. You can only sign up for it once a year when the sign-up period is passed, but she does Rich Mom University, and it's a lot of Etsy training there. But any sort of handmade business she helps with. Etsy is something they focus on a lot. But I don't like to sell online, so I really wouldn't have any tips. Honestly, it changes a lot because people try to game the system as far as getting their stuff recognized. So Etsy's always changing, and I would definitely follow her channel because she gives a lot of that stuff away for free, like tips and stuff. And I'm really not an expert, so I can't help you.
Marvelous Myrrh, should I get a bunch of colors or just a cool and warm version of each primary?
I would do a cool and warm version of each primary or a set. Sometimes it's more affordable to get a set. You could do a set that's got a good variety. Like this one here, this is a cool and warm of each primary. It's got more colors than you need, but you know, if you look around and you see a set, it might be cheaper to get and actually get more colors. So, either way is fine, I think.
Rich Bowden, what manner of doggy is Sarah's doggy? Well, she's part retriever, part shepherd, and mostly dumb, but we love her. She's a good dog, and she's crashed out on the floor after getting busted trying to sneak cat treats from the cat box.
Naughty dog.
She just loves the cat box. Alexandra Johnson, what kind of paper do you recommend for beginners?
For beginners, I recommend, because I know it can be prohibitive to go get 100% cotton paper for, you know, when you're just starting out because it is expensive. But I find that the Strathmore in the brown package, it's the 400 series, is quite nice and it's not very expensive. You can find it at Jerry's pretty inexpensively. It's going to be more at your local stores, like your craft stores, but craft stores you can use a coupon. Which I would recommend doing that or waiting for a sale. But I find that can take quite a bit of lifting and scrubbing, and it performs quite well. It's not as durable as 100% cotton, but, you know, it's not bad. And for the price, it's definitely great for beginners. I don't notice if you're a beginner, you might not notice the benefit of having 100% cotton paper yet anyway. So I would recommend the Strathmore 400. Not the yellow label paper. That stuff is a little harder to work with. Get the brown labeled paper.
Crazy Evil Turtle. Lindsay, if you could take only 2 watercolor pencils camping for plain air, what colors would you take? I'm thinking a light gray and muted green.
Gosh, 2 colors?
I know, right?
I don't know if I would bother. 2 colors. Oh, geez. Probably burnt sienna and ultramarine blue. Because I can mix them together and get a full shade of warm and cool grays.
JPC 13 Art, have you ever tried wood burning?
Yeah. I have. It's not for me.
In case you couldn't tell by the tone of voice. Yeah. Gracie Shack, canvas or oil paper? I was wondering which is the best to get for doing oil paints the first time.
Either way, if you get a canvas, it's going to be a lot easier to deal with if you really love the painting, like to display it and frame it. But there's nothing wrong with using the canvas paper, as long as it's formulated to use with oil paints. Otherwise, it might dry too quickly and be kind of a pain. But I think it's whatever your budget, and, you know, it's mostly a budgetary thing. The canvas paper should be a lot cheaper. If it's not cheaper, go with the canvas. That's the only reason I would probably use the paper, is because it's cheaper.
Joe Maskey, Lindsay, is this about an 1/8 sheet size?
Exactly. Yep. I'm going to skip up to this one because I don't want to run that pedal. So I'm just going to wet this one and then put my colors in. I'm kind of thinking maybe I probably should have used that red and I would have had a little bit more vivid colors, but I don't know. They're pretty bright. This flower is pretty bright, I guess, as it is.
Monica Paula, have you ever tried color Micron pens?
I haven't.
I haven't either. I just have the basic black ones in the assorted sizes.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I used to. I like that I could do watercolor with them, and that's usually what I did. And then I recently discovered that you could use your Copics over them and they didn't run, or any of your alcohol markers. And so that made them even more attractive. But I never... I typically wouldn't draw with the colored ink, and that's what I would use them for.
Lorelei Philauer, what are some good watercolor brushes for cheap? I think we answered that earlier.
Yeah, I think so.
Skip that one, sorry. Do you want me to go thrash the children's submission?
Oh, I think they're fine. Okay. Hope you guys don't mind a
little thumping around.
Pretend it's thunder. The kids are playing. That's all right. They're not on screen, so.
Kaber 99, what is the best choice to start with, color pencil or watercolor pencil?
Totally depends on what you want to do. If you like to paint watercolors, watercolor pencils are nice, but I don't use them for the same things. If I'm going to sit down and do a colored pencil piece, I'm going to be layering colored pencils and I'm going to be looking for that creamy consistency. And, it's very different than painting with watercolors. So I think that's completely up to how you want to work. If you want to turn it into a watercolor painting, or if you want to have I wouldn't do a complete colored pencil work in watercolor pencils. Personally, I would use regular colored pencils because it would be a much more enjoyable experience and you can get a lot more color-wise and whatnot out of your pencils. So I think it depends if you want to use them as colored pencils or you want to use them as watercolor pencils. I'm going to blot that's a little too much color there.
Sophia Tamburo, when did you start painting with watercolor paints?
When I was 7.
20 years.
Yeah, 20 years ago. I wish.
Cubear 99, I'm afraid to use watercolors than more afraid to use color watercolors than colored pencils. My thoughts are I'm going to waste paper.
More afraid to use colored pencils or more afraid to use watercolor pencils?
More afraid to use watercolors than colored pencils.
Well, you can get by with much cheaper paper with regular colored pencils. You know, if you're not going to add water to them, you can use, you could draw on a grocery sack. I mean, and still get a decent look. So, so maybe colored pencils are right for you. You can sketch on cardboard, do some really cool toned work on cardboard. And colored pencils generally are cheaper than watercolor pencils. So go ahead and try that.
Lonnie, I got Koi watercolors and my paints are cracking and lifting out of the pan. How do I fix this?
Add a little honey or glycerin to it, and that will act as a binder, and it will keep them a little bit of moisture in the pan so they don't just dry right out. Because usually student grade paints don't have as much glycerin as artist grade, and they don't have as much binder, so they tend to dry out like that. All right, we're going to do this last petal here, and then we'll work on the buds.
Faye Salkis, when mixing colors, how do you mix more color if you run out? Is there a trick for matching?
Just practice. You know, you'll get the hang of it. Or you can make a color chart. And to make a color chart, what you do is you take your palette and you would make a big grid. So this is 12 colors, so I would make a 12 by 12 grid, so it would be 144 squares. And then you would paint all your colors going down one way and then all across the other way, and then you would follow your grid and you would say, okay, I've got my red over here and my yellow over here. You meet them and you mix them. So you make a grid mixing all those colors. And then when you need to replicate a color, you find it on your grid and then you can look and see how much of what color you used. So that's a great way to learn. But probably by the time you're done making the chart, you will know how to mix color and you won't need to ever look at it again.
You'll be a professional mixer.
Yeah.
Anita Scott, why are cadmiums not recommended for children?
Because cadmium is a cancer-causing agent. And kids aren't really that great about washing their hands after they're done.
Or not putting them in their mouth.
Yeah, so that's why. And I mean, if you use your paints properly, you should really not have to worry about using cadmiums or cobalts. But if you're going to dip your brush in your teacup, then there's a chance that you can get sick from these chemicals. All right, now we can let this dry. We can go over and put some wrinkles and textures on top after. We're going to go in and work on the buds. And I want to get a nice fresh green color. So I'm going to use my my lemon yellow here. And some of that, also want a little bit of yellow ochre. So it makes it earthier. A little bit of that green that we used in the background. That green's super strong, so...
Debbie K's. Do you recommend stretching paper first by wetting then drying?
Well, if you want to stretch your paper, you need to wet it and then stick it down on a board and tape down the edges with gummed tape so it can dry. It can dry at its most stretched point so that it won't wrinkle when it's when you apply water to it. You don't just want to wet it and then let it dry and then paint on it, because that it retracts back to its size. It doesn't give you any benefit except it washes out some of your sizing, and that is not what you want to do. So you just want to soak it and you want to tape it down to your board while it's still wet using a tape that's got a water-activated adhesive. You can't do just regular masking tape or it's not going to hold it.
Ian Jackson, have you had a go with Golden's watercolor paint core?
Yeah, I used some last week at on the Seascape tutorial. That was all the core paint.
Oh, that's right. It was, wasn't it?
Yeah, I love that paint.
Lie-by, any tips for avoiding condensation when storing watercolor paintings in the acetate sleeves?
The only time I ever had a problem with condensation is when didn't you notice that too? Like, we put our cards
in
and stuff.
Sun.
Yeah.
Like, whatever moisture there was like sucked out.
Yeah, we had done a craft fair or a farmer's market, and we brought our stuff out and it was in acetate sleeves. And the sun, like, it pulled any moisture out of the packaging. So that's the only time.
Maybe make sure your painting's fully dry.
Yep. And if that does happen to you, just open the package and let it kind of wick out. That's all I did. I just opened everything
up.
Yeah,
that's what I did too.
Let the moisture out.
Let them air dry.
And that worked.
Aura Blue, what artist grade paint would you recommend?
There's a lot of really good ones and the prices vary like crazy. I really want to try the Mission Gold.
Yeah.
A lot of people have been asking me to review it, and I did contact the company to see if I could get a sample to review, but they never even emailed me back. So that kind of ticks me off that if I email
them. They're lost. Just lost how many Google Crafter fans?
Not that I would necessarily expect like a huge sample, but I would expect information like, oh, our paint's superior because of this or this or this. But give me the time of the day and tell me why I should give a crap about your paint. Pardon my French there.
That's not French. I'll show you people some French. No, I'm just
kidding. But yeah, so, but then again, but it's really hard to pass up because I keep seeing the, there's a pure pigment set that they have that looks, it's like 15 milliliter tubes, which are pretty big tubes for watercolor. And it's 24 of them and it's like $85. So it's a little under $4 a tube. And some
that's
of this.
That's pretty good pricing.
Yeah. And it's all single pigment because they do also have a set that's with a palette. So 36 colors, but they're mixes. And I'd rather have this single pigment color. I'm just dabbing in a little of that magenta at the tips of these open buds here. So that's something I really want to try. I think they're that's pretty cheap as far as professional grade goes, but I haven't used them, so I can't really say go ahead and buy them because I don't know. The Lucas ones, they tend to be they seem really transparent while I'm working with them today, but when I did a little swatch, I felt like they felt a little more opaque, and maybe it's the minerals that they use, but they did feel a little more opaque to me, but they are a good buy. They're made in Germany. And German-made products usually are pretty good as far as our supplies. Yarka. I like Yarka a lot. And they also make the White Knights brand. That's probably as cheap as you're going to get a quality palette for. And they also have the student-grade Sonnets available, which are also very good. And the light fastness rating on those were pretty good, too. So,
Judy Smith, how are you keeping your colors from bleeding into the background?
The background's dry where I dried it with my heat tool. You could use a hair dryer or just give it a little time. And it won't blend if the background's dry. So the watercolor paint's only going to go wherever it's easiest for it to go. It's going to follow the path of least resistance. Okay, so I'm going to let that dry. And I'm going to go ahead and start adding some details on the flower petals themselves. I'm actually going to hit that real quick with my heat gun just to make sure that there aren't any damp areas on the petals.
Jen K, would Lindsay check out my photos on PMP? It would totally make my week.
What's her username?
She didn't say. Jen K.
Jen
K. I don't know if that's the same one on PMP, but.
Well, go ahead. Go on PMP and friend me or follow me. Send a friend request or sign my guest book. Do something so I can see who you are. And then yeah, I'll check out your photos. I'm going to make some color for glazing. I'm going to start with the magenta, and I'm using a smaller brush. I'm using a number 4 round Mimic Kalinske because I don't want to have too much paint, so that's why I'm going with a smaller brush. I actually have to clean off my palette. I don't have enough room to mix there.
Caro 85174, I see a Schminka. Someday I'll get them all right.
That's a tough one. And I hear it say both ways, okay. So I wouldn't worry about it.
Schminka 12 half pans for $77 Canadian.
That sounds actually pretty reasonable. Their paints are expensive. I have not used their paints. I've used their pastels. I really like their pastels, but I have not used their paints. So I'm just putting in these kind of shadow areas. Then I'm going to go in with a smaller brush, and I'm just going to kind of drag some of the pigment out so it kind of feathers it out and gives a little texture to the petals. I'm kind of dry brushing there. And I think I'm going to add a little bit of yellow to that because that feels a little too cool. And I'm just using the smaller brush to drag it up because it won't hold quite as much water and I'll be able to get some of the veining.
We've had several idea requests, and we'd like to remind you that Lindsay asked that you put any ideas or suggestions for future tutorials on the Facebook page, the Frugal Crafter Facebook page.
On the website.
Website, I'm sorry.
Yep, on the
Frugal Crafter website. She's not going to remember while she's painting and doing this, but if you jot it down, she can write it down in her notebooks.
Yep, there's a page set up. It's just called Requests and New Videos, and just put it there, and I will see it. Because that's where I go to look when I need an idea. I go through and I look there.
C. Sawyer, how do you dispose of dirty water?
I just dump it down the sink for watercolor water. You can go dump it outdoors if you're worried. This isn't going to hurt my sink. And there's such small amounts of pigment in there. I'm not worried about contaminating my ground or anything because we do have a well. If you were working with some really nasty stuff, which I don't think your watercolor paints would be that bad in the amount that you're using, you could always let it evaporate and then, you know, throw the silt in the trash, but generally with watercolor, it's pretty benign. And if you're really worried, don't use, you know, cadmiums or cobalts or anything like that. I'm just adding in some little flicks of magenta just to give it some veining. You could switch to whatever brush is comfortable for you.
The Musical Scrapper. Can I use glycerin with powdered pigments to make watercolor instead of gum arabic?
You need some binder. Glycerin's not a binder. It's a wetting agent and a preservative. So you would need something like gum arabic to make it stick or it will flake off. But gum arabic isn't that expensive. You can find it at Jerry's. I think they have like the Perlex brand for like $2 powdered. So you can just use whatever you need mixed up with water as you go. Actually, I prefer the liquid gum arabic personally, but $2 is pretty cheap if you're just looking for some gum arabic to get you through. And you just want to continue going on and adding veining in your different flowers. Like here, there's actually kind of like a swell of the petal. So I'm just getting that shape in there, and I'm just going to put the veining underneath that so it shows that this is kind of puffed out and underneath is kind of recessed. And same thing over there. I'm going to do it again.
Lie-by, how did you avoid a halo around the figures? I'm assuming she means around the flowers.
Because I went right up to that area when I did my background. So I wet it with water, then I added the pigment. The pigment only went where the paper was wet. So I didn't have, if I hadn't brought my water right up to the edge, I would have had a halo. But I wet right up to the edges, and I made sure it was nice and wet before I added my color in.
Look up, down, Ani. Have you ever used pastels to build up a still life painting?
I did a couple weeks ago, actually, during the live stream. If you want to look back at that tutorial, I did a background. The background was watercolor, an old painting that I didn't like. And then I built up pastels on top of that. And that was just like 3 weeks ago. If you want to go back in my on my channel and check that out.
The Dark X0X23.
That's a mouthful.
It is. Any tips for shading skin? I finally caught your stream today, and I have to say thank you for all your tutorials.
Thanks. Well, I do have a lot. We did a portrait on one of the lives, so that's pretty in-depth. But generally, I think if you can do the skin wet into wet and have all your colors mixed and ready to go, you're going to get a much more good blend and shading if you can do as much at once as possible. And then after I'm building onto a face that's dried, I would add the color on top of the dry paper, then I would go in with a clean damp brush and I would spread it around so I don't have any hard edges.
Gracie Shack, does Lindsay have any ideas for what camera to get to record my tutorials?
Anything. I mean, really, whatever you have for a camera will be fine. If you have a phone, smartphones have decent cameras on them now. I wouldn't let technology be a barrier. Just use what you have. And I wouldn't go out and buy anything until you see if you really like doing tutorials. There's no point going and spending $500 or $1,000 if you're not sure that you're going to want to keep doing it. And I mean, it's YouTube. People are used to things shot on their camera phones. And the phones have gotten really good now. So that's what I would recommend until you're, you know, either making money from it or sure that it's something you want to do long term.
JPC13 Art, how can I get good lighting for my videos on a low budget?
Go to the hardware store and get aluminum clamp lights. And they are, they're just these aluminum reflector lights. They're about $8. And then I would put daylight balance CFL bulbs in there. And that's what I use down here. And I like it because I don't have stands on the floor to trip over. I have them clipped to my ceiling.
Very easy to move, too.
Yeah, very easy to move. And then just buy the daylight bulbs as you can afford them. And if you can't afford the daylight bulbs, you can't find them. Just use regular cool fluorescents. And just when you white balance your camera, it'll account for the fact that you've got fluorescent lights. Just try to keep all your lights the same. So your camera can just balance to one, and you won't have yellow patches or green patches anywhere. And don't be afraid to turn your paintings as you're working to make sure that you are painting at a comfortable angle for what you're trying to reach. I can hear the dog and the kids. I doubt the microphone's picking that much of it up, and I don't think it's going to bother anybody.
It bothers me. There, she's right behind you, Lindsay. Don't take a step back. You'll trip over the dog.
Surprised Chewy's not up with the chickens.
She wanted to be, but I would not let her. She would chase the chickens, and then she would eat their chicken poop.
Oh, Chewy.
My dog is gross.
Will you ever grow some manners, Chewy?
Nope. She's 9, and she doesn't have manners yet.
It's a lost cause.
There'll be no manners. She's an old dog.
She can't help it. It's just what dogs do, right, Chewy? Can't help it.
At least it's chicken poop. I mean, it's just veggies and grain, so.
That's true.
How do we get started on poop? Let's change the subject.
Yeah, really. Does anybody have any more questions?
Hannah D, would tempera paint work for this?
Yes, it wouldn't be quite as transparent, but yeah, tempera is more like a gouache, but it's a little bit runnier. And it's generally what children use in school. You can use it thick like acrylics, or you can use it thin like watercolors. If you're working on paper like this and you thin it down, totally. You might not get as vivid of a color, but again, it totally depends on the brand of Tempera. And I don't really know Tempera brands very well, so I couldn't give you a recommendation.
Princess Beyonce, what is a halo?
Well, a halo could just be like a gap of color, like where you have, white. White, if you didn't bring the color in. Some people call blooms halos. If, let's say you went to paint a background in around, like you paint your foreground in, you're trying to paint around it, and you have a big puddle here, and that puddle pushes the pigment away, that could give you a little halo effect. Basically, it means kind of like a glow around something. Now, I feel like I want to have a little bit more foliage here. I think I'm going to go in with my Zen brush for this and mix up a nice earthy yellow green. And that Viridian in there is so strong that I'm going to just try to pick up what I have on my palette and just use some of the yellows I have just so I don't get too much green in there. And also I can clean off my cakes of yellow color while I'm at it.
Keita, what do you think of line art, especially combined with watercolors?
Oh, I think it's beautiful, especially like a pen and ink and watercolor. That's lovely. I like it. All right, so I have a nice soft yellow here, and I have a well-loaded up brush, and I am just going to kind of put in some foliage, just really loose. I just basically feel like the background's a little too too distant. So if I can put in some sharper areas here, it's just going to make it look a little bit better composition-wise. And I'm keeping the paper dry and my brush is wet.
A wild carrot appeared. Have you tried the Dollar Rowney Aquafine watercolors? If so, what do you think of them?
Actually, yes. I went and I looked in my travel box. And come to find out, I had a full set of those in there, and I must have, I don't know how I came to get them, but I must have thought since I had a whole set, that would be the perfect thing to bring for students if they run out of a color. And I think they're fine. I mean, they're not, they're student grade paint, but they're not bad. I wouldn't let them sit in my palette. I probably would just squeeze out what I needed, because generally with student grade paints, they tend to just kind of crack in a palette, but yeah. If you have them, use them. I don't know if I'd recommend going out and buying them if you don't have them. I'm just going to tap in a few little spiky shapes here. This is a politician answer, isn't it?
Yeah, it was. Yeah.
Sorry.
That's fine. Kind of, you know, you kind of have to be a little bit in case somebody gets offended. Lie-by, didn't you do an interview about marketing art recently? Where can I find it?
I did a interview with Renee Christine a while back, and it would be if you just, it's probably in the Ask a Crafter playlist. If you just go to my channel and search Renee Christine, it should show up, or search Rich Mom Business, it should show up. All right. I think that just about does it for this painting. If you have any questions, go ahead, pop them in the chat right now. I will take a photo of this when it's all dry, and I will put it on my website, thefrugalcrafter.wordpress.com, so you can take a look at it in detail. Oh, you know what? I need to add a few more remainings to that one. We'll do that right now while you guys are thinking of your last questions for me.
Well, Joe Maskey.
Okay.
Lindsay and Sarah, off topic question. What types of music do you each enjoy?
Oh boy, I like a lot of different music. I like, my favorite band is The Cure. I like David Bowie. I like, I also like Bob Denver. Or is it John Denver? I always get confused. Who's Gilligan and who's the singer?
I think it's John Denver's the singer.
Okay, I like John Denver. I like Peter, Paul, and Mary. I don't know, I like a wide variety of things, but probably, I wonder if there's much overlap between your music.
There's probably zero. You know, I do like, I do listen to the 80s, you know.
Yep.
But usually if I'm in a group, some of my favorite bands, I really like Born of Osiris. I love Nine Inch Nails. I love Lamb of God. I'm more of a metal, hardcore, As I Lay Dying, although they're not around anymore because their lead singer's in prison.
Find upstanding bands you like to follow.
So very different, you know, more metal hardcore stuff. You know, I'm usually at the metal hardcore shows and I'm one of the old people that's there, but I'm okay with that.
Oh, that's fine. Good question. Any others?
I think we're all caught up.
All right. Well, I think that does it for today. I hope you guys give this a try. The reference photo is in the video description. And if you're looking for some more painting inspiration this weekend, Craftsy is having a 50% off sale, their top classes. Ooh. So there's some really nice watercolor ones on sale. I always have a special link for my class so that fans can get it at 50% off. But go check it out. They also have like cooking and woodworking and photography and also sewing, lots of sewing and quilting classes. In the top class categories are on sale right now, so go check them out if you're looking for a project to do this weekend. Every purchase, no matter if it's my class or somebody else's, one of the other fine instructors, helps my channel tremendously, and I do thank you for your support. And if you're looking for supplies, check out jerrysautorama.com. I'm happy to have them every week as a live stream sponsor, and their support keeps these programs coming every week. Thanks so much for watching, guys, and Till next time, happy crafting.
Bye.
Bye.